Thank you. some green, some red roses too. I see them blue.
John 2, this is the legacy we have from you. You taught us love and how to fight. You gave us strength. You gave us might. A stronger person would be hard to find. And in your heart, you were always kind. You fought for us all in one way or another, not just as a husband, not just as a father. For all of us, you gave your best. And now the time has come for you to rest. So go in peace, you've earned your sleep. Your love in our hearts we'll eternally keep. Good morning, my name is Kathy, and I'm your celebrant for the farewell of a man who lived his life to the fullest and surrounded by family and friends. And that man is John Raybould. On behalf of myself, the staff of Peter Murray Funerals and the Raybould family, I'd like to welcome you here today and to thank you for coming and sharing in the celebration of John's life. I'd also like to welcome those that are joining us via the live stream and no doubt sending their love across the miles. Following on from the ceremony, John will be privately cremated, but the family would like to invite you back to the RSL where you can continue to share your memories while you enjoy some light refreshments. Some of you have known John your entire lives and others came into his life throughout the years. But no matter how long you knew John, you knew him, you had a loyal family member and a friend for life. I've known John too. Well, people might recognise me, I work at the hospital. And John still holds the record, 45 years of employment. I did a bit of snooping because I thought that somebody picked him at the post, but no, 43 years is the next record. So John still holds it. He'll be missed by everyone who knew him, but especially his wife and best friend, Rosie, his children Tash, Cindy, Paul, Kelly and Bart, son-in-law Tony, his sisters Jane and Mary, and their partners Colin and George, his many grandchildren and great-grandchildren, nieces, nephews, and his many friends. John was born on the 15th of March 1940 at home in Fairfield, England, to proud parents Harry and Eileen. He was the eldest of three children with sisters Jane and Mary. John was a bit of a rascal right from his younger years. He was known to wag school quite a bit. In 1950, the family migrated to Australia as 10-pound poms. They spent their first night in Melbourne before moving to Lakes Entrance after being sponsored by a gentleman called Len Parks. They began their life in Australia with Harry and Eileen being caretakers at the Woodbine Caravan Park in Lakes Entrance. They then moved to Lake Bunga in a bungalow that Tommy Chandler had built on his property. The kids went to the Lake Tyres Primary School, which is now known as the Tuller Arms School. The family moved the bungalow from Lake Bunga to Ross Street in Bairnsdale, and Harry was a local milkman and Eileen worked at what was known as the Benevolent Home as a nurse. After a while, the family sold the Ross Street property and moved to Buchan and then to Nowanowa. Harry had become an apiarist at this stage, and John would often help out with the bees and their hives. John enjoyed helping Harry with the bees, and when Harry passed away, John continued with the bees, excuse me, and they became a big part of his life after his retirement. It actually became a full-time passion, and Rosie was right there with John. John commenced work at the Collins Mill in Orbost, and then in 1959 he started working as a labourer for the Lemkin and Schultz builders. They were building the commission homes in Bairnsdale at this stage. Then in 1961, John started his long career in the maintenance department at the Bairnsdale Hospital. As I said before, he was an extremely hard worker and a well-liked, and currently known as the longest worker there, 45 years of employment. John was married and had other relationships, and out of these came the best things in John's life, his children, Tash, Cindy, Paul, and Kelly and Bart. In 1997, at work in the staff dining room, he spied this good-looking lass with a German accent. He made some smart remark to her, which is not politically correct anymore, but she quickly came back with a smart reply. And this is how John and Rosie began their relationship. After dating, they fell in love and tested their relationship by travelling to England and Germany to meet each other's family members. Their love became even stronger, and in 2000 they got married and had a honeymoon in Tasmania. They were never far apart, going on motorbike holidays, cruises and trips around Australia, as well as working in the same place at Bairnsdale Hospital. There's several trips to Darwin and cruises to Noumea, New Caledonia and New Zealand. There were the motorbike rallies which went all around the country, including Western Australia. John had a huge collection of badges that he collected over the years from the rallies and are proudly displayed on the wall at home, and also over there on his coffin on the rug and his vest. In 2007, John retired and loved his retirement with more travel and playing golf. John and Rosie worked well together. They built the home in Wyong, from making the bricks to laying the timber floor, and Tash pointed out this massive timber beam that they had said they had no idea how John and Rosie managed to put it up in the ceiling. John was a very talented man and he was always on the go. He built several boats, and once they were done, he actually painted pictures of the boats, which are in frames on the hallway wall. And I didn't know he painted as well. So when I said he painted the boats, I thought they just meant the actual boats. I said, no, check out the pictures. In 2016, John was diagnosed with colon cancer and he had surgery the following year. In 2018, he was diagnosed with secondary cancer in his lungs. He had treatment and continued with his life and did some more travelling with Rosie. His attitude was to live life while you can, no matter what. Late last year, John was once again given news that the cancer was back, and this time in his brain and also in his bones. He was able to stay at home with the love and support of his family and the palliative care team, who the family would like to thank immensely for all the support given to John, Rosie and the family. They'd also like to thank Dr. Josh Hearn and Dr. Shah, the oncologist. On the 12th of January, John passed away peacefully, surrounded by his family, and most of all, he was surrounded by love. I'd like to ask if anyone would like to come up and share some personal memories with us of John. Be brave. None of the ex-workmates. I'm not putting you on the spot or anything, am I? No? Okay. back at the RSL, that's where it all happened, and there's probably a lot of memories, more memories that can be shared at the RSL that probably can't be said here via the live stream. So make sure you do it. Happy times come and go, but memories stay forever. By taking a photo, you're helping to keep that memory from running away. Luckily, John, Rosie and the family love to capture moments with a camera, and after going through hundreds of photos with laughter and tears, they have selected special moments to share with you now.
no matter what they tell us, no matter what they do, no matter what they teach us, what we believe is true. No matter what they call us, however they attack, no matter where they take us, we'll find our own way back. I can't deny what I believe. I can't be what I'm not. I know I love forever. I know no matter what. If only tears were laughter, if only night was day, if only prayers were answered, then we would hear God say. No matter what they tell you, no matter what they do, no matter what they teach you, what you believe is true. And I will keep you safe and strong, shelter from the storm. No matter where it's barren, a dream is being born.
Referring to that he actually painted lots of family photos, and there's just two that we can't unsee, two photos up there. You know which ones I'm talking about, Rosie? Say a picture's worth a thousand words. Well, those pictures are worth a lifetime of John. Today you've been remembering with love a man who'll be greatly missed by you all, mostly his family. In the days, weeks and years to come, continue to talk about John and share your memories with each other. Visit special places that remind you of him and embrace reminders of him as they come. It might be a song that you've heard today, or it might be the Collingwood footy theme song, meaning that they actually won a game. Remember John for the loyal friend he was and how he was so kind-hearted. When you're out fishing and catch a big one, maybe John was there helping. Or if you're out playing a round of golf, just maybe someone's guiding the ball. Remember how he used to joke and was known for his quick wit. From the early age, he loved a good joke, and I was told that he even got his mother drunk one Christmas without her realising what was actually happening. He was well known for his delicious pizzas, which he made from scratch, including the base. And he also made a pretty good stew too. He had a few favourite foods, including seafood and sponge cakes. Whenever he was asked what sort of cake he wanted, he always opted for a sponge cake. There was a few of them in the photos too. He was tolerant. And when I asked if John had a favourite show or movie, there was a bit of laughter before I was informed that he watched Home and Away. Not because he liked it, but because Rosie loved the show. And so he sat me through and watched it. That just goes to show what a good husband will do for a good wife. Later on, back at the RSL, you might like to have a drink in John's honour. And I'm sure that he would have one with you, whether it's a wine, a Jim Beam, a Pepsi Max, or I saw him with a few beers in his hand as well. So go back and have a drink in his honour. I know there are many more ways that you'll remember John, and I'm sure each memory will have a special place in your hearts. I'm going to close with a reading that we think John would have liked. And then once I do that, we're going to ask family and then friends if they'd like to come forward and place a sprig of rosemary onto John's coffin. As you know, the rosemary is a plant of remembrance, and it has actually come from the garden at home. So I'm going to read something titled, Pardon Me for Not Getting Up. Oh dear, if you're hearing this right now, I must have given up the ghost. I hope you can forgive me for being such a stiff and unwelcoming host. Just talk amongst yourself, my friends, and share a toast or two, for I am sure you'll remember well how I love to drink with you. Don't worry about mourning me, I was never easy to offend. Feel free to share a story at my expense, and we'll have a good laugh at the end. Thank you all for coming.
And first we're going to come place a sprig on John's coffin, the chair ceremony there.
Thank you.
Say goodbye to John. We're going to play a final piece of music, and it's titled My Friend the Wind.